YouTube, Edgar here, and welcome to Artifexian. Here you will learn everything you ever wanted to know about world building, and then some. There are arguably 6 steps one must go through in order to create a constructed language, or conlang for short. 1. Select the sounds your language uses. 2. Create a lexicon. 3. Create grammar. 4. Design an alphabet. 5. Modify it for handwriting. And finally 6. Begin writing and translating text in your language. Notice, step 1 does not state chuck a whole lot of letters on a page, sprinkle in some apostrophes and diacritic marks, set a pronunciation, and boom, language complete. Despite what you may have read in some fantasy novels and comic books, this right here is utter nonsense. Forget about letters and alphabets. In the beginning, there are only sounds. Broadly speaking, sounds or phones exist in 2 forms, consonants and vowels. The IPA, or International Phonetic Alphabet, is a collection of all possible sounds humans can produce, with each unique sound represented by a unique symbol. People in cliques tend to circle jerk. The English letters C as in click and C as in circle jerk represent 2 totally different sounds. In IPA, we have a separate symbol for each of these sounds. Throughout these videos, I'll put the English words and the English representation of certain sounds in quotes, and the IPA symbols in square brackets. Anyways, back to the IPA chart. Consonants are here, vowels are here, diacritics or sound modifiers are here, supersegmentals like length, stress, intonation, and rhythm indicators go here. Good conlangers will select a set of sounds from this chart to use in their language, a phonemic inventory if you will. Having a fixed phonemic inventory that can constantly be referred back to when creating words will ensure that your language has a strong internal consistency. Now, the selection process of what sounds go into your inventory should not be random. If you're writing a novel and you want your readers to be actually able to speak your language, aim for familiarity. Choose sounds that a broad demographic of people will be able to A, recognize, and B, easily produce. So stay away from exotic sounds like kosa or konotwane. Same idea, perhaps even more so, applies when creating auxiliary languages like Esperanto or Interlingua. Maximum familiarity is key here. For example, I don't speak Interlingua, but I'm pretty sure this text reads Esse va il mondo scientific, specialmente le branca medical, che Interlingua veramente se mostrava utile post su apparizione in 1951. And even if I'm pronouncing it entirely incorrectly, I'm still getting a feel for what is being conveyed. Something about the use of Interlingua after 1951 in the scientific world, especially in medicine. Another way of making a conlang seem familiar, yet sufficiently different, is to modify existing phonologies. Imagine English without a ba or la sound, or German with a kia or gya sound. I'm a staunch advocate of less is more when it comes to sounds. So in terms of adding to or subtracting from existing phonologies, the removal of features always trumps the addition of features. Why? Well, sound is very much like colour. Using all possible colours in a single painting will lead to a characterless, sludgy mess. By limiting his colour palette, a painter imposes upon himself creative restraints, which can lead to greater clarity and beauty. Language is no different. Less is more. That said, Tong, spoken in parts of Botswana, may, depending on how you're counting, feature up to 141 distinct phonemes, whereas Central Rhodocas or Piraha feature as few as, wait for it, 11 distinct phonemes. Now granted, this is an oversimplified statement, but it does demonstrate the varying scope of phonemic inventories. Another factor determining what sounds your phonemic inventory can contain is biology. If your speaker is human, then this isn't a huge concern. Things change when it comes to aliens though. Perhaps your language will be spoken by an alien race that have no lips, so can't produce sounds like ba, wa, or pa. Or no teeth, so sounds like da or ta are out. Or maybe they can't produce nasal sounds because they lack a nose. On the other hand, they may have 2 or more vocal tracts and can produce sounds unfathomable to us earthlings. Perhaps their mouths are shaped in such a way to allow for more places of articulation. Or maybe their airstream is different. High velocity airflow could produce high pitched sounds and emphatic consonants. Again, I would advise less is more. Your earthling readers aren't going to dedicate time to evolving a second vocal tract just to be able to speak your language. Nonetheless, all this needs to be considered. So regardless of why and for who, the creation of an internally consistent language starts with some solid sound selection. With that in mind, the next few videos will take you through most, if not all, the sounds a human can produce, so you can make an informed decision as to which sounds are in and which sounds are out. Stay tuned. Good morning, interweb. I hope you enjoyed the first artifacting video ever to deal with linguistics. Now this is some seriously uncharted territory for me, so any feedback would be much appreciated. Let me know what you think about all this in the comments. Oh, and in case anyone missed last week's video, I launched a podcast. If you're interested, go click the yellow box for more. And as always, if you want more artifacting content in video form, click the links below me. And finally, if you think I deserve it, hit the like button and maybe give me a subscribe, and I will see you next time. Thank you all so much for watching. Edgar out.